Hello everyone. Once, while a monk was speaking to a gathering of believers, a young man asked him, "Master, how should I best use my day so that God will be pleased with me?" "There is only one possible answer. Live a life of love," replied the monk. Minutes later, another man asked the monk the same question, "How should I best use my day so that God will be pleased with me?" "There is only one possible answer. Live a life of joy," said the monk. The first man was taken aback and told the monk, "But, Master, the advice you gave me was different."
"Not at all," said the monk. "It is exactly the same."
Friends, love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your souls, and with all your strength, and with all your mind. And love your neighbor as yourself. Whoever loves father or mother or son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. Anyone who does the will of my Father in heaven is my brother and sister and mother. Friends, these exhortations of Jesus are worded slightly differently, but the message is essentially the same. Today's gospel is a part of Jesus' mission discourse to his apostles as he sent them out on their own to preach the good news. He called the 12 men and gave them the authority and power to preach and work miracles, as well as gave them travel instructions, warnings about persecutions, and at the same time, words of encouragement. You may remember last week we heard Jesus encouraging the apostles to openly proclaim the gospel without fear of anyone who might be able to hurt their bodies but not their souls. Rather, fear the one, referring to God, who has the power to inflict destruction upon both their bodies and souls. At the same time, he reassured them that they are more valuable in the eyes of God than other creatures on earth, particularly referring to sparrows, which were so common and inexpensive at the time of Jesus. Friends, in today's Gospel we read Jesus placing further heavy demands upon the apostles. First, he demanded total and unconditional loyalty from the apostles. He said to them, "Whoever loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me, and whoever loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me." Friends, these words are very authoritative. It is difficult to imagine that Jesus, who had taught the apostles to love even their enemies, warned them that if they loved their mothers or fathers or children more than him, they would not be worthy of him. In fact, in Luke's gospel, the language is even stronger. Jesus said, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, and even their own life, such a person cannot be my disciple." In other words, the apostles' love for Jesus had to take priority even over their love for their parents and children. They had to choose between the love of Christ and the love of family. Friends, the suffering and martyrdom of the apostles testified to the sincerity of their faith in Jesus and their love for God more than for their family. Secondly, Jesus demanded self-denial and self-renunciation. He told them, "Whoever does not take up his cross and come after me is not worthy of me." Friends, many people interpret cross as a kind of burden which they must carry in their lives. Referring to a strained relationship or a physical illness or the taking care of a disabled person in the family, they might say, "That is the cross I have to bear." But this is not what Jesus meant when he said, "Take up your cross and follow me." When Jesus carried his cross to Calvary to be crucified, no one thought of the cross as a symbol of a burden to carry. At Jesus' time, the cross meant only one thing: death in the most painful, cruel, and most humiliating way. Friends, today we Christians acknowledge the cross as a symbol of atonement, forgiveness, grace, and love.
But in Jesus' day, the cross represented nothing but a tortuous death.
So, take up one's cross meant carrying one's own execution device while facing ridicule and humiliation on the way to death.
So, by taking up the cross and following Jesus meant the apostles were to willingly, consistently, and wholeheartedly accept humiliation, mistreatment, persecution, suffering, and hardships with complete acceptance, submission, serenity, and without excuse or complaint, but joyfully follow Jesus.
If they did not love Jesus more than they loved their family and take up their cross and follow Him, Jesus said they were not worthy of Him.
Friends, what does not worthy of Him mean?
Not worthy of Him means, as Luke explains, not worthy to be called Jesus' disciples.
That is to say, if the apostles had more love for their family than they had for Jesus, and if they are unwilling to accept suffering and hardships, they were not qualified to be the followers of Jesus.
They were not worthy of God's favor or the reward Jesus intended for His disciples.
Thirdly, Jesus demanded their life.
He said, "Whoever finds his life will lose it, and whoever loses his life for my sake will find it."
Friends, what does "he who finds his life will lose it" mean?
In worldly terms, finding one's life means a person is in quest of one's own pleasures and passions during their earthly life.
If a person knows what pleases self, he then goes after it.
Slowly, over time, such a person becomes more selfish and greedy. He begins to accumulate and hoard things for himself.
Let us remember the story of a man who approached Jesus and asked what he must do to inherit eternal life.
Jesus told him to observe the commandments.
When the man replied that he had, in fact, been observing all the commandments since his youth, Jesus told him to go and sell whatever he had and give it to the poor, and then take up the cross and follow him.
But the man was very sad to hear these words and went away sorrowful, for he had great possessions.
Friends, what stood between Jesus and the man was not so much wealth per se, but an unhealthy obsession for money and material goods for the sake of prominence, power, position, and recognition.
Friends, pride is a barrier to our total love for God.
Often temporal goods and human pleasures may pass or end quickly and leave us so empty.
So Jesus said that anyone who chooses to go after such a life will lose it.
Instead, he said, "Whoever loses his life for my sake will find it."
Well, what does this mean, losing one's life?
Losing one's life means that a person has to die.
Well, we all know that is a reality we all must face eventually.
But in this context, we are not talking about physical death.
What this means is basically the same as taking up one's cross and following Jesus.
It means that the person no longer lives for himself but for Christ and his teachings.
Jesus becomes preeminent in his life.
So Jesus says, "Whoever loses his life for his sake will find the real meaning of life."
That is to say, when a person allows Christ to direct his life, he will gain eternal life as promised by Christ.
The reward in losing secular life is finding life in Christ.
If a person never finds Christ, or if he rejects Christ, he loses life.
Instead, if he denies self and follows Christ, he will find life.
Finally, Jesus gave words of comfort, reassurance, and hope to the apostles.
He said to them, "Whoever receives you receives me, and whoever receives me receives him who sent me.
Whoever receives a prophet will receive a prophet's reward,
and whoever receives a righteous man will receive a righteous man's reward.
And whoever gives only a cup of cold water to one of these little ones to drink, because the little one is a disciple, amen, I say to you, he will surely not lose his reward."
Friends, These words were said, first of all, to comfort the apostles, lest they should conclude from the account of the sorrows, afflictions, and persecutions they were to meet with, that there would be none who would receive them and their message. Therefore, Jesus indicated that there would be some who would embrace the gospel preached by them and receive them kindly into their homes and treat them in a very hospitable manner. Secondly, for the encouragement of such persons who risk their own goods and lives by so doing, Jesus let them know that receiving of his disciples would be regarded as having received himself and therefore also his Father, and all that they did to them would be taken as kindly as if done to him personally, and in like manner would be accepted by his Father, and that they would be duly rewarded. Friends, what is the message for us? 1. We are reminded today that Jesus has laid down seemingly heavy demands on us in relation to true discipleship. Although normally children should love their parents and parents should love their children, our love for Jesus and his teachings must take priority over family loyalty. Jesus is to be loved above all creatures and above the nearest and dearest relations and friends. 2. We must willingly deprive ourselves of desires, wants, and possessions and accept rejection, humiliation, ridicule, suffering, sorrows, and adversities, and courageously follow Jesus. If need be, we must willingly and joyfully give up even our very life for the cause of Christ. 3. Like the rich woman of Shunem, who showed the prophet Elisha hospitality by providing him not only food but also a room with the simple furnishings, a bed, table, chair, and lamp during his travels, we must be just as hospitable to all God's servants, priests, brothers, sisters, missionaries, lay ministers, and all those who bring the gospel message to us, and provide for them. Let us remember, when we are receptive to others' needs, particularly of God's servants, then God will provide us with all that we need and more than we want or can imagine, as He has promised. Amen. God bless you.